Hey, good morning. It's Mike Bowen, USAT Rules Ambassador for the Southeast Region. And Happy New Year in advance to you guys. I'm doing this video just a little bit early. Just want to make sure that I've got at least a voice to work with. And so I wanted to talk a little bit about something that came up while I was visiting the Gulf Winds Triathletes in Tallahassee a couple of weeks back. And somebody mentioned in passing, as they were introducing me, that that my job is to catch cheaters. I take a little bit of an issue with that. I don't like to think of myself as being a person who catches a cheater. USAT officials, most of us, if you were to ask us, what do? 90% of it is we educate. You know, we teach people. We tell you what the rules are. We try to explain it in a manner that's simple as possible. And then the other 10% is, okay, it's race day, the whistle blows, and okay, now we got to write violation reports and be the bad guy. But more often than not, we would rather not have to write penalty reports. We'd rather explain the rules to you and make sure everybody's safe and fair out there. Okay, so there is a qualitative difference, in my humble opinion, between what happens when you violate a rule, competition rule, and what happens when you decide that you're going to cheat, okay? The biggest thing there is intention. And that's where USAT officials, we write violations based on observations. There are areas of the USAT competition rules, I would say, when you're talking about doping control and unregistered participation, most officials aren't going to know if you've violated doping control or if you decided to participate in a triathlon as an unregistered participant. You know, if you got a bib number and race numbers and stuff like that, and you're in transition, we're figuring, hey, you're supposed to be there somehow. I will say that my first assignment as a head referee, we did have somebody pick up their packet and participate in the race, and they had not paid the registration fee to the race director, and she had to chase them down and was very worried about the fact that they did not pay for the registration fee. And I said, yeah, that's one of those issues, I would say. So that would probably possibly be cheating, okay? So having said that, there are some things. If you know, cheating, if it's something that benefits one athlete and perhaps poses a risk to other athletes and violates the spirit of sport, you know, excellence in performance, dedication and commitment, respect for rules and laws, respect for self and others, you know, those are big, broad areas of what they call spirit of sport stuff. So if you're talking, let's say general rules, USAT rules, if you're using the unfair advantage, if you're holding or grabbing or pushing another athlete, you know, in order to keep them, you know, keep them from having, you know, taking advantage of you, that would be cheating. Endangerment, behaviors on the bike or the run course that would endanger another athlete, that's definitely cheating. Flagrant or willful violations, let's say over a course of several races you decide that you're not going to wear your helmet on the bicycle out of transition onto the bike course or leave it unstrapped, and we've seen this with a few guys, that's definitely going to be, I would call that as cheating. Starting in an earlier and improper wave's kind of a borderline thing, you know, cutting the course, a little more so, closer to cheating. Using fins, gloves, and paddles, things that would, you know, get you through the water faster than your fellow participants, that would definitely be a cheating thing, okay? Running, technological fraud, bike stuff, cutting the course, you know, by a vast amount on a bicycle or a run course, that would be most likely cheating. Not, you know, if you're not gaining just 1 minute, but you're gaining a whole bunch of time, that would be cheating, okay? Once again, we're looking more for intention. We're not looking for intention. We're looking for the actual act itself. And we don't try to divine what an athlete is thinking in the back of their mind when they violate a rule. It's like, you know, because how many times have I had this afterwards? When we see somebody drafting, and they, you know, if they come into the draft zone and then they drop back out of the draft zone, it's like, okay, that's drafting. That's what the rule says. And they said, well, and people will say, well, I didn't intend to draft. I didn't intend to break the rule. And in those cases, we're like, no, but this is what we saw. Now, if you are riding your bicycle and you are riding, you know, 1 meter back from the bike in front of you, and you're doing that for an extended period of time, you're basically sucking wheel, you know, we're going to look at that and say, yeah, that's intentional. That they're showing some intent there. And we've seen that, and that's where you go right from that gray area of, oh, I violated rule two. Oh yeah, I'm cheating. All right. So that's all I got to say about that. Remember, most of these things that I've examples are stuff that are right out of the rules. A little bit of this is my own personal opinion, but there is a fine thin line between violating a rule and cheating. Remember, it all has to do with intention. And, you know, we can't look at, we don't know what you're intending to do, but there are certain rules violations that have some serious intent behind it. I promise to do better next time, and I'll see you hopefully in the next couple of weeks. Have yourself a fantastic new year and a great day. Okay? Bye-bye.